First reading of FRM part 2, are you excited?
Yes.
I don't see the excitement, no. Alright, so we're starting with Basel. I thought we should start here because this is a lot of fun. And in terms of our learning curve, it's going to be steep. Today we have discussion primarily on Basel 1. And then in the next session, I'm going to have discussion on Basel 2 and Basel 3. And I think it's kind of fun to learn them in sequentially because you kind of also understand the progress of how regulators have been thinking about banking industry. So first we start with basics, that what is Basel 1 or what are Basel norms? I'm asking you, what are Basel norms? They're norms on banking activities. Correct? Maintaining capital or maintaining assets. So then here is my question. Now listen to this carefully. Do you agree that banking is one of the many businesses an individual or a company can do? Correct? So those businesses could be, let's say, doing a FMCG business or doing an IT business. Have you heard of a separate regulator for IT industry? Have you heard of a separate regulator for FMCG industry? Then why are separate norms just for banking industry or maybe insurance? Why? Because we're dealing with public's money. The risk involved is higher. Okay, so here is the general thought process on this. And see, it gets very interesting now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to build a bank's balance sheet here. So on one side, we will have equity and liability. I'm going to write it on the left-hand side. No particular logic there, just convention. On the other side, I'm going to write assets. Let's assume this is the bank's owner. This guy decides, you know, one fine day, he gets up in the morning, he says, you know, today I'm in a good mood, I want to start a bank. So he goes and withdraws money from his bank and he decides I'll set up a new bank and he puts an equity of let's say 1000. Then he starts making advertisements, hoardings, outdoor media, newspaper, and he invites a lot of small depositors. And let's say these depositors come in and these guys put in 4000, let us say, in the form of fixed deposits. So the deposit that you and I make in a bank, is that bank's asset or liability? That bank's liability. So let's say these deposits are invited at a rate of, let me put a random number here, let's say 10%. Now what is the total cash available with the bank? 5000. He takes that money and then he starts creating assets out of it. That assets is nothing but loans. So I'm ignoring all the reserves and all the regulatory part. We're just looking at it from a broader perspective. So he gives loans of 5000. Let's say on an average, the loans are given at a spread of, let's say 15%. So your average cost of borrowing 10 and your income at 15, the distance of 5%, what do we call this? NIMs, correct? We call them as net interest margins. So we are not getting into nitty-gritties, but on a very broad level, we will say that your NIM, net interest margin, is 5%, and that's what banks' business is, right? They're borrowing from one direction, they are investing into another direction. Now let's see how the income statement is going to look like. So we will say interest income. Tell me, how much will that be? Seven. Interest income, how much? 5000 into 15%, that would be 750. Interest expenses, 400. Let us say we have some salary and other operational cost. Okay, so let's say that operational cost is 100 And ignoring the tax part, what's your profit? Your profit is 250. Now this owner, this gentleman is a, let's say a baniya. Do you know who a baniya is? Who? Yeah, in case if you don't know, Google. And every time he does a business, the way he thinks is, he thinks, what is my munafa versus what is my lagat? What is my profit versus what is my investment? So right now, what is his profit? 250. So his profit is, let me write that somewhere here. Profit is 250. And what was his investment? Investment was 1000. And he gets 25%. Do you know what this number is called? This is called ROE, return on equities. So his ROE right now is 25%. Now the baniya, the promoter, he looks at this, he analyzes carefully, he thinks, if I were to put my 1000 somewhere else, I would have easily made 30-35%. Which means he is not happy with current ROE of 25%. So now a new character comes into play. Let's say this new character here, this new character is the new CIO or CEO or CFO of this bank. So the baniya hires this guy. He says, do whatever you want to do, but make sure that my ROE increases. I am not happy with ROE of 25%. I would consider your salary is worth it if my ROE becomes, let us say, 40%, 50%, 60%. So somehow you try to increase my ROE. So now this new CEO is analyzing the business carefully and he realizes the only way I can increase the ROE is somehow if I can increase the profits. So how do I increase the profit? So he first goes and analyzes this loan book. Then he sits with his sales team and he's asking them, instead of 15, is it possible if you give them loan at 17? And the answer is, if you give loan at 17, forget interest, probably you're not even get your principal back because you would be taking too much of risk. So this cannot be changed. This is going to remain 750. Then he goes to this depositor and he checks with them that, is it okay if instead of 10, I give you 9? Then the depositors will say, ki aapke baju wale dukaan mein chala jaunga. And aapke baju wale bank mein, I'll go to the bank which is next to you. They'll offer 10, which means you cannot change this. So this is going to remain 400. You cannot get rid of the employees. Correct? Which means you cannot work on the profitability. It is going to remain same. So what can be done? So here's his idea. Here's what he does. He goes to these depositors and he says, we are accepting additional deposit of, let us say, 800 more. So now my total deposit is original 4000 plus revised 800. So total deposit, how much? 4800. But this time he does not give loan of that 800. He calls up the baniya, the owner of the company. And he says, your investment in my business right now is 1000. Please take 800 back, buyback or dividend, whatever it is. So what is the new equity now? New equity is 200. What is the size of the balance sheet? Is it same? Yes. So your balance sheet size is same, but the composition changed. Now compared to what we had earlier, now what we have more, what? Tell me. We have more debt. This is called leveraging the balance sheet. So you reduce the value of equity and you added more leverage on your books. Now again the same story, loans 5000 at the rate of 15%. So this is 5000. Now let's make an income statement. So I'm going to call this scenario as before and this scenario as after. So now interest income, how much? 750. Interest expense, how much? Is it going to be 400 now? No, it's going to increase. Why? Because now we have to pay interest on that 4,800. So interest expense is now 480. Salary expense, how much? 100. So how much profit are you left with? 170. Now the CEO is tensed. There's going to be a meeting between, let us say, the CEO and the owner this afternoon. Let's say they're meeting for lunch. And CEO is extremely stressed because he thinks, before me, profits was how much? 250. Now profits are how much? 170. So he thinks maybe the owner will fire me. So they're meeting at a particular place, let's say a coffee shop or some restaurant, and this CEO is sitting waiting for the owner to come. Owner walks in and immediately kisses CEO on his forehead and he says, "Well done, I'm proud of you." Tell me why. Because the baniya has a different metric of evaluation. He doesn't look at the number of profit. He looks at munafa divided by lagat, profit divided by investment. So what is my profit now? My profit is 170. But in the revised structure, I wrote 2000 here, I should have written 200. In the revised structure, what is my equity? 200. So how much is that in percentage term? That is 85%. So you can look at the dramatic jump in ROE just by adjusting the equity on the books. So if you think of it, that every equity shareholder of a bank, he wants to have good ROEs. And the job of the management of the banks is to provide them good ROEs. And one very easy, very smart way of having great ROE is to have small equity base on the books. Okay, so we are going to very core of why we need Basel norms. So think of it, every bank inherently is incentivized to reduce the value of equity on the books. Correct? And by reducing the value of equity on the books, they're able to produce better ROEs for the shareholders. Now imagine a situation. Imagine now, if this is our before and after scenario, in one particular year, something goes wrong and there is a default of 10% of assets. 10% asset default. So total default of how much? 500. Now, if there is a loss of 500, who will absorb those losses? Equity shareholder. So absorbed by equity shareholders. Correct? But here, if there is a 10% loss, there is a loss of 500. 200 would be absorbed by equity. Agree? Now 300 is still pending. So you call up the owner of the bank, you tell him you have to deposit 300. So he will say, "Have you ever read the name of my bank carefully? The name of my bank is XYZ Limited. What does that word limited mean? It means my liability is limited to the extent of amount I've invested. So if my 200 is gone, it's gone. Legally, I'm not supposed to pay more. I'm not going to pay more. So if I'm not going to pay more, who will bear those losses? 300 is to be borne by or absorbed by depositor. Now put yourself in the shoe of that depositor. I'm sure some of you have fixed deposit. How many of you have fixed deposits here? Of course. So let's say Trupti. Which bank, Trupti? Really? Are you bluffing? You look like Bank of Maharashtra client. Are you really Citibank? Okay. So let's say Trupti is banking with, let's avoid the name of bank. Let's say XYZ Bank, a reputed bank that never sleeps. Now one fine day she gets a call and the person on the line says, "Unfortunately, there have been defaults on our loans. So we will not be able to pay back half of the money you've invested." Imagine if that happens. What will happen next? Trupti will go to the bank. वहाँ पे फैल जाएगी. तृप्ति विल गो टू द बैंक, शी विल क्रिएट अ बिग रकस, शी विल गो ऑन ट्विटर, सोशल मीडिया, शी विल गो ऑन FC रोड, स्टार्ट शाउटिंग एंड टेल एवरीवन दैट सिटी बैंक इज नॉट गिविंग हर मनी बैक. What happens? Everyone else who's deposited in the Citibank will also want to go and withdraw money. Maybe even other banks, people will be worried. And the entire banking structure, if you think of it, it works on the trust. Imagine if, like, the reason why we make fixed deposits, because we think it's safe. Technically, it's not, but we think it's safe. Imagine if you and I stop depositing money in the bank, then the banks will not be able to go and give loans and the entire economy would be in trouble. So from a regulatory perspective, it's really important that these guys are protected. You cannot allow the small depositors of the bank to absorb losses. And this equity that we have, I want you to think of this equity as some sort of a cushion. That it's a cushion that if something goes wrong, these guys will absorb losses first. And after equity, then if there are any losses, then it will come to the depositors. And that is the reason why regulators want equity number to be higher and then banks want equity number to be lower. That's the whole equation. That's the primary focus of most of the Basel norms. Of course, there are other requirements, but the main focus is going to be on the capital requirement. So now regulator will come and they'll say you'll have to maintain XYZ percentage of capital as a percentage to your assets. Is that making sense? Okay, ask me questions now. Are you convinced with this? Okay, so I want you to write it. Today you can write on your classroom notes, but next class I want you to buy those post-its. Has anyone bought post-its? Good, yeah. Can you show it to everyone, please? I'll put it on the camera as well. Okay, whatever it is, I want you to buy post-its of this size. MRP is 100 rupees. So don't buy the cheaper ones. Do not buy post-its of only 3M. Do not buy 3A, 3X, 3Z. The reason why I insist on 3M is the quality of adhesive. Like, I have no vested interest except for the fact that I own their stock. But the quality of adhesive, this is phenomenal. Like, you apply this, you remove, you apply, you remove, you do this 20-30 times, they will still remain sticky. And that's how we would be using them. Whenever we generate them in the class, next day you guys will go and put this onto your wall. Then after a few days, you would bring it back and then you would be putting it again. Are we okay? So start writing. So it's very interesting. I've been reading up a lot on implementation of Basel 2, Basel 3 in India. And I've been reading some report by the analyst. And one statement that I keep on reading constantly is that as a equity shareholder of a bank, you cannot expect banks to have the same level of ROEs that the banks had in previous decade. Like in the next 10 years in India, you cannot expect banks to generate the same level of ROEs that they generated in the past. Why do you think analysts are saying this? Correct. So banks are being required to have larger value of capital. In India, like, we've been little conservative. So our capital requirement is, let's say, ballpark number 1% higher than roughly what Basel 3 requires, like somewhere in that range. Plus there is implementation of capital conservation buffer, then counter-cyclical buffer, like all these. So regulators are forcing banks to accumulate a lot of capital on the books. And what that is going to do is the denominator of your formula is going to increase. But that capital is not going to help you increase your numerator significantly. Your numerator will be there more or less, which means going forward, the ROE in the banking sector is going to decrease. Okay, that's a great question. Question he asked, is accepting deposit the only way banks can add leverage or they can add more leverage? So in fact, accepting deposit is just one of the many ways through which banks' equity and liability side is made. Maybe one assignment for you guys is today, you can write down the assignment. Download three Indian banks and let's say one JP Morgan and Nomura. So download five financial statements of these five banks and analyze their balance sheets. Okay, some of the other sources is, for example, JP Morgan, Nomura, and three Indian banks, and then read through their balance sheets once. Okay, just for fun. But there are a lot of sources through which banks can add leverage. For example, banks can issue bonds. A lot of Indian banks are now issuing bonds just so that they can meet that tier 1, tier 2 requirement. So there are a lot of new issues happening. I think Jammu and Kashmir Bank is in the process of issuing bonds. Is SBI issuing bonds? So a lot of Indian banks are also issuing bonds. That's one source. So you can add leverage either in the retail market or in the wholesale market. There are also at times investors who would park in a large value of bonds. There are structures which are issued to these investors. So these guys will invest, let's say 500 crores, 1000 crores, 1 crore is 10 million. Even that adds up to the leverage. Does it answer your question? Then the next question he asked, that let's say if an institution is buying bonds of a large value from a bank, is it a part of equity or is it a part of debt? It depends on what type of bonds those are. Whether they are convertible, non-convertible, whether they are contingent convertible. So we'll have to learn the definition of what constitutes tier 1 capital, tier 2 capital, and then we'll have to determine. But in general, the moment it's a debt, you're adding leverage. So from a Baniya perspective, when I am buying equity shares, no matter how Basel defines, my definition of equity is simply going to be the equity on the books, not the other components. Should we go ahead now?